23 minutes? Oh, I know.
That's what.
Well, they told me as long as I kept my middle still, so I had my arms out, you know, because they put me in the wig work.
You ready?
My head and my arms were out.
All right.
So I could at least go like this.
Time is now 6:30. I'm going to call the Tuesday, December 11th meeting of the Chilton Planning Board to order. Our first case is a continuation of Planning Board Case 1213 for Charles Sargent. This is for shed and garage business to display buildings on property leased from Gaslight Village on Laconia Road in the Mixed Use District.
And unfortunately, I'm going to have to ask you for another continuance because they cannot make up their mind on how they want to arrange the parking situation. Well, they have to get together and vote on it. And every time they get together and vote on it, they haven't decided yet. That's all I know. It's as frustrating for me as it is for you. I don't know what to say at this point in time, other than I'd like to continue it if possible.
Not an annoyance for us.
No big deal on our end, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Continuance?
Wait a minute. Make a motion.
We continue it to the next planning board meeting?
January 8th.
Good. Okay.
2013.
Okay, good.
The holidays aren't going to prevent them from voting?
Guaranteed they will.
Probably. So as it is right now, I'm not looking to do anything up there until spring anyway. So until this whole process gets resolved, I just want to continue working on it, and try to get it done as soon as possible so that it doesn't go past the spring.
You could go to the 22nd.
Why don't we make it for the 22nd? Right. And that way I can be sure that I have all my ducks.
Okay.
We have a motion.
Gus, you have the letters in there?
I will get him a letter. I don't have one right here, but okay. I will get him a letter to you to sign for continuation of this case.
Okay.
To that time frame, because we have 65 days to complete the case, and we've run over that now, so.
Okay.
And I will send it to your house. You'll sign it and send it back to me.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
All right?
Mm-hmm. All right. You have a very good day now.
Okay.
So it'll be
January 22nd.
January 22nd.
At
6:30.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nobody seconded.
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Yes. All right.
Have a very good night.
You too.
Have a happy holiday.
You too.
Yes.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
No, happy holiday.
All right. All right, we have Robert Callahan is here to discuss possible changes of use for his building located at 100 Auburn Drive in Chilton, New Hampshire, in the rural agricultural district, and I pass it every day.
Do you?
Come and visit.
No one there.
Go up there every day?
Just about, when I go up to the brain.
You're close
to
there.
Oh, you go home.
There's no one there.
Through San There's nobody there. I'm there. I go there every day. I'm almost there every day.
Pickup truck?
I'll wave.
That was me the other day driving around in case you refuse. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, you see me. I'd love to take you through
check,
it.
Check it out.
I go to the senior center. That's why I pass it up every day.
Okay, yeah.
So I'll wave the next time I see you.
Calm down.
You
can check my mail or just making sure I walk through
it. It's a beautiful building.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
But it wants a change of use. So let's hear the
right
speak.
Well, I mean, the building is very versatile.
Do you mind?
Yeah. The building's just a great building, and I laid it out. As you know, we try to propose the movie business up there, and we did. We ran movies, and we run commercials in there. But it's not enough. It's not enough, and they're not running up here from Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had people come and rent. They move out. They come in. They move out. You know, we get a lot of single space rooms. Last 2 years, I've had over and over people telling me, geez, you know, we need an indoor sports arena up here. And so I'm like, no, you know what? Don't want it. Didn't want to deal with it. Put enough into the building. Let's see if we can just rent space to corporations, companies, that type of thing. And last couple months, I've been taking my son down to Bull. And it's a very low impact business they have down there. They have an indoor soccer arena. You can do all kinds of indoor stuff. It's really neat. And if it's possible to, you know, that's why we're here. And it's as simple as really laying out carpet. Except in this case, it's AstroTurf. They seam it just like carpet. And they put netting all around it. There's no structural. We're not changing anything. We're not moving the building. We just have one big open warehouse that would fit the need. And before I go on, before I go off and do any real research on, you know, the cost of putting it all together, and the carpet and the netting and stuff like that, I just want to see if it was possible. There's a need because people are sick of driving an hour to go down to Ball. And so that's what we're here to see if it's.
You know. How much parking do you have there?
I have 75 spots. Yeah.
That was my only concern
when I that's what I figured. And you know, I studied. I was down at Ball. And they got three arenas, okay? So when I go down there, I bring my kid, and there's 10 other kids on each team. So it's 10 kids on each team.
My son plays down there.
So you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Is he on Winsquam FC?
No, he's on Lakes Region.
All right.
Is he? Yeah. So you know, and I thought, you know, the traffic would be tremendous, but the only time there's going to be heavy traffic is at the switchover.
Right.
I couldn't see more than 40 cars. And, you know, maybe 50 cars at the most coming in out of there. But I don't even think it would be that many.
We have a lot more than that on site.
Oh, yeah. We donated the space to the fire department. We must have had three full-size fire trucks in there, at least a couple hundred people. We filled a lot up, no problem. But, you know, as far as space for that, there's plenty up there for that.
I mean, even regularly, when FEMA was using it for those 2 months.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they had, 45, 50 cars oh, sure. every day, plus their trucks in and out.
Yeah, right? Yeah. So, you know, that was definitely a concern, but, you know, just judging one arena, because that's all we get space for.
So. And you have a variance for warehouse type stuff in there, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I have the phone. You have the.
Yeah. Is there a site plan in here from when they were in the last one?
Yes.
Couldn't you fit a couple of fields in there?
Could only fit one. If I took everything out,
yeah.
I could. Yes, I could put two in there.
No, it's right. The one you had in your hand.
No, they also do this one? Downball, yeah. Softball practices and softball camps in the summer.
That's right, yeah.
Well, there's one off exit 17.
That's what was confusing.
Everett, yeah.
And if you look
over there,
there's a decision for
the. There's one off exit 17, which is a smaller one. Now, the Little League utilizes that. That is more of a versatile thing because they actually have an upper level where they have batting cages.
See, I could put those in also.
They have like an upper. It's
a mezzanine. Like,
have you ever been in that building?
No, I haven't.
It's a multi-use building.
Yeah?
They have. I mean, there's an ambulance company there, there's an auto repair, but it's a huge building.
Right.
And I think your building is actually bigger than that.
Right.
And they actually have one long area that they divide in half for people to play. They can either play big kid, you know, bigger people.
Right.
And if you got a little kid, they don't need as much room, so they have a net that goes across.
Right, right.
And Baseball,
yes.
Little League, sorry.
Yeah, pitching, batting.
Yeah, they actually rent that for a couple times a year. They do winter clinics down there.
Right.
The baseball teams, they all go to that facility because they have baseball facilities there.
Right.
Then you have Bow Fieldhouse.
Right.
Which is, they have primarily do soccer there.
That's right.
There are other places. I know there's a place in Drake at Mass. When I used to live there, they do deck hockey.
Yes.
Which is basically they make a hockey rink and they have like a hard rubber floor in there.
Right.
And they do deck hockey in there. It's right.
You probably do racquetball. There's probably a lot of.
Well, this is more team sports. Racquetball you wouldn't really do.
Yeah, anymore. I don't have a setup for the racquetball. We certainly get a mezzanine to do that. Indoor mm-hmm. golf, you know, just the netting stuff for it. People have talked about you know, yoga. Classes, bring a chiropractors out there. I mean, you know, quite a space.
Without line spaces, I saw, you know, I couldn't visualize the parking. I drove all the way around the building.
Yeah.
And, you know, could you put 75 spaces in there? I don't know because I didn't know how to measure it.
Yeah.
As a point of reference for you, I would go inconspicuously to Market Basket, ask for Mike LeClaire,
You know what? I did meet Mike over the summer.
He was proposing putting the one in Belmont.
I know it. He had a hard time up there or something, didn't he?
He had an issue with water or sewer connecting somewhere.
Right. I did. I spoke to Mike. Was it this past, this winter? It was summertime, maybe. And I told him, I said, if you're interested, come on over. I'd love to show it to you. So I don't know if that's conflict with his job or he couldn't come over. Or, I know his boss. I think that might have something to do with it.
Yeah, I don't know. But he's the store manager over here.
Yeah.
He was looking at doing that, and then the economy tanked.
Yeah, that's what we're, we're stuck. That's what we're stuck with.
Absolutely. But he was thinking more about a bubble.
Big dome job. Yeah.
A big bubble thing, obviously he had a bigger expense, but you already got the building.
The building's there, and it's going to be an expense to put, buy the stuff and put it in, but, the bathrooms are in place, all my egresses, exit.
There is a need for it in the marketplace. Just
do you think it could be filled up here? If I was to think that was of being at full, I never in rough numbers, I would think maybe Monday through Thursday, 5 to 9,
yeah,
something like that.
Yeah.
And then the weekends maybe.
Fieldhouse goes until 11 o'clock at night sometimes, 12 o'clock at night.
They get the population but, down there. I'm
well, wondering. No, they're pulling teams from up here.
From Franklin, my son goes down there.
They're pulling.
Do you think there's enough to put it there? The only thing is, the rink wouldn't be as big as like these ones over here, down in Ball. Be a little bit shorter field.
Yeah, I don't think.
But you know what? They're not real games. It's not a full size in there either.
It's indoor rink. You gotta have room for bleachers.
I figured that out too.
But I think you could pull.
I think you pull people from up north.
Well, I think you pull definitely
Meredith,
from the state, New Hampton Holderness. School, Tilden School, the Holderness School. Some of those places do have facilities, but
and maybe even some of the schools from right here.
Yeah.
Does Tilden have anything like that? The prep school.
I don't think they have an indoor.
I keep going there,
but they have a. I know they have a. Just a skating rink.
That's all they have that I know of is a skating rink.
Yeah, no indoor turf field.
No, I don't think so.
I know a lot of the people associated with my son's team, which is the one Squam FC. There's an under 12 team, there's an under 10 team.
Yeah.
This is the second year for some of the kids and the first year for a lot of them. For two teams is our first year.
Right.
And he also coaches a lot of kids for the rec league through the Pines.
Yeah.
But I know, and he plays indoor sometimes down there too, and I know there's a market up here. There's a lot of kids, people that don't want to drive down there.
Guilford and Laconia alone, there are a lot. And it's an hour. It takes me an hour to get there from Guilford. Meredith, right?
I would think there would definitely be a need.
Yeah, I think the need's there, and I know.
The old man field house.
That's right, Old Man Fieldhouse. That's right. I haven't even thought about a name yet.
I already got it.
All right.
I already ran through my head and drove through it. And I looked around. And I just thought it would work.
Well,
I don't know if it's legal up there, but I thought it would work.
If you look at the municipality owned and privately owned outdoor would be permitted, but as soon as you go to indoor commercial recreation facilities or amusement facilities, then it's not permitted, so you would have to go, you'd need to go visit the ZBA. Only because it's indoor. I mean, this is silly the way it's written, but unfortunately the planning board doesn't have the authority to go against what the zoning regulations say.
All right.
But it would require, I think, because you're indoor, I know you already have your variance for warehousing and stuff like that, so it's already been variance for uses other than agricultural.
So. Yes, yeah. Well, I think, what's the inside?
It's light manufacturing, which is, and the definition was film and TV production and everything else. I mean, we put that into place years ago before even Bob was on the scene.
What's the occupancy in there? Is it 500 people?
No, it's almost 700.
700.
It's 600 and something in the big box.
Right.
Without employees.
Yep.
Because we have all that broken down by rooms from the fire department.
What's the
commissary is 662 or 65. The theater is the same, about 65.
Right.
And the big box, and the big box takes more if the doors are open too.
Right.
That's right, that's what it was, right?
I'm sorry.
I mean, is it used at all now? I mean.
I got a lot of boats in there for storage right now. Yeah, it's, you know, it's been sitting up there. We've had several people interested in buying it. That's never fallen, you know, come through. So maybe if I fill it, it sells. I don't know. But it's getting a lot to carry out there, and I've got to figure something to put in there.
Is there sewer and water up there?
No, just septic, and I got a couple of wells.
Right.
When's the next ZBA meeting?
State of the art fire system.
January, it's on a Monday.
28th.
Yep. Thank you.
January 20th or February 20th?
January.
Wow. Do you only meet once a month?
Yes.
Wow.
Sometimes not at all.
Yeah, only if they're not required.
Meet on the 31st or the 24th?
No, I don't.
And they moved it to Mondays, and then we had to move it from the third Monday to the fourth Monday, because the third Monday is a holiday for the town.
So what would I need to do? To sign up for that?
You'd have to sign up for a variance. Is it a variance? You'd need a variance, okay, so you'd have to sign up for a variance.
120 by 80.
That seems like an emergency.
Yes.
It's 240, the section that's open is 120.
Right, by 24 feet to the grid.
Yeah.
We certainly get the height.
36 feet.
We get the width, it's just a little short that way.
Right.
Okay.
Right, okay, now, if he gets that, does he still need to do a site plan? Amended site plan?
I would say yes.
Okay.
Because we're just going to want to look at his parking, where he's going to put the people. You know, and I think it's only fair to the people that live on the street that they might want to come and be a part of the whole.
Because there might be a considerable more traffic on that area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know the road's been redone, but still.
Yeah, the road's nice.
They call that road redone?
That's much nicer than it used to be.
Oh, really? Oh, all right. Oh.
Yeah,
you go to the end, then you'll see. It's like a new highway.
Yeah. It looks like there once at one time was a double yellow line on that road.
Yeah, there was. It's a state road.
Yeah.
Is it a state road?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They didn't paint it this year.
Wow.
I didn't think that road.
Discuss it with the state and see what you get.
Why don't Lancaster Hill
use
state road
for the building? Mm-hmm.
I know the baseball teams, like when they're looking for early season, they like to do stuff. But then in the summertime, all those places would die off until the fall. It was a very seasonal.
Yeah, you're probably 32 weeks a year.
Yeah,
right.
Summer weeks, you know.
There's stuff happening.
But I mean, I see up here, the Tilton Northfield Lily would be a thing, probably Cal Ripken leads up here.
Sure.
The schools, you know, the baseball teams, the soccer teams.
The Guilford soccer team practices at the Gunstock ski area parking lot.
Yeah.
You been out on that?
Oh, yeah.
Are you kidding me? Imagine that ball bouncing everywhere.
That's good for knuckleball. I can't think of my coach's name right now.
So we will hopefully see you again.
Yeah. Now, where do I bring this back to?
To me.
Right back to Augusta. Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And if you have any questions, Gus will be happy to help you.
Thank you.
With any of them.
Well, thanks for coming out tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Good luck.
Yeah. Well, we got time. There's nothing we can do until May, anyways. April.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh,
have a good night.
I'll just
you
too.
I'll give
you one. Yeah, there is one.
not there yet.
Okay, so we're.
What are you doing, sir? Yeah.
I know they have a lot of cars up there, but not on the regular basis.
That's all I could think of.
The what?
All I could think of was people who aren't really on the line.
No, they have a lot of like evening things going on and.
Sandy? They're just asked that if they get the variance to do this, can they revert back to what it was?
Warehouse, yeah, because you're gonna have a variance.
Or the TV station, the TV or the movie.
Okay, that's good.
That's always there.
It's always there when it's in place?
Yeah, okay.
So that's, so it wouldn't affect it because we're, you know, Bob's still in negotiation with someone, we really.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, you've got that variance.
Remain in your center.
But it stays with the land, so if you sell the place, whoever buys it.
It goes on, great.
But the, it will not exclude what it's already, the variance is already for.
No.
It just expands what.
Unless.
Can't be taken away.
Unless for whatever reason the zoning board makes that a condition, but I can't picture that happening.
Because the biggest part of the problem is that there is, we've got 25 finished offices, really the potential for some 30 plus finished offices. I mean, the T1 lines in there, all the, you know, the internet connections and everything else. So, you know, that part of the building gets rendered useless unless we can, you know, fill it with people with sports related interests. I mean, we got the largest green screen north of Boston for the filming of commercials and drive-in. I mean, companies have, you know, made training programs in there. You know, if you haven't seen the building, it's really quite remarkable.
I have a silver Tacoma truck. If you ever see it, come over.
Yeah.
You there tomorrow?
Might be. Or you set up a time, I'll be happy to. I go out there every day. I walk through the building, just to walk through it.
You there 10 tomorrow?
What's that?
I'll be there 10 tomorrow.
Will be at 10?
Yeah.
What day is tomorrow? Tomorrow is Wednesday. I'll see you at 10 o'clock. Do you have a card? Do you have a phone number?
No.
Okay. Well, if something happened at my office.
If you're not there, you're not there. If you're there.
Okay, you're close, so, okay.
I'll go check it.
Okay.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
It's pretty good place.
I know.
Just, yep, they have the rent. Do you think you're looking at the room right now?
Right.
We're still being recorded, I won't say anything.
All right, the next thing on the agenda are the planning board minutes.
I've got a couple here if anybody needs them. Anybody needs them?
Yes, yes.
There's copies to pass out, if anybody needs them.
Do you have them, Bob?
Nobody has them. You notice all the signs that the other tree belongs around town? And a couple of places?
I put Mr. down at number one, the continuation, halfway down the page, that number one.
Oh, that one, okay.
Okay. Mr. Sargent requested a continuation because he is in the process
of
working
yeah.
out details.
Working
out details.
Okay, I don't know. Mine printed on the first full paragraph on the second page that I've got, which starts out, Ms. Buzner began by explaining. The very end, he said, he added changes which the planning board received to review. I changed two to four review.
Okay.
And then skip the next paragraph and down to the Board of Selectmen have. It should be has, because board is singular. And then the next paragraph, you got,
that was confusing.
Yeah, the board had no objections to the easement between Mr. Bernard and the, and Tilton Senior Center. I changed that to 570 Laconia Road LLC in the town of Tilton because that's what you're talking about.
Yeah, that's true.
Is it 570 or is it Haven Grove?
Haven Grove.
Well, see, up in that first paragraph, Ms. Blesner, you know, it says walkway easement between 570 Laconia Road LLC and the town of Tilton.
Yeah, Haven Grove is the parking lot.
Haven Grove is the chiropractic building.
Yes. 570 Laconia Road's the parking lot.
Yeah, okay, I was getting confused.
And then the first paragraph after CIP, the highway department, period.
No S.
DPT, period, has submitted a, and I just crossed out the number 10 and spelled out 10 because that's the proper way to do it.
Oh, okay.
And then, you know, if somebody is reading this minutes for the first time, they may not know what LRPC is, so I spelled that out, and then in parentheses I put LRPC. And once you spell it out once and you stick it in parentheses, then from that point on you can say LRPC and they will know.
But I bet you do that once in a while because it could have been done then 2 years ago, 3 years, four years ago. And
you could have somebody new to town and they're reading this and saying, what the heck is LRPC?
Okay. Yeah, you're right. We just know what in it.
Yeah. And then I had, after reviewing the plan and a public hearing.
After reviewing the plan? Okay.
And a public hearing, the board can approve it for use.
Well, on the side of signage. Yeah, you already know what I'm going to say. Let the board know what he feels does not work and how he thinks it should be changed to make it easier for the public to understand.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was waiting for somebody else to
say. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I missed that.
I missed that one, too.
Really?
Really?
I have,
and I don't think we have on that last sentence, get their input on the signage and how the town can improve the regulations.
Okay.
Take
that are currently in place.
Regulations currently in place? What do you want?
Well, I don't think you could add that in there, but I think that implies that.
Even if we have in place, that's correct.
I'd say that are being currently enforced by.
What do you want? Current regulations currently in place?
Currently in place.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And on the page 3, Ms. Blesner stated these statements were added, and I put in two. The subdivision regulation when plans were coming. This whole thing is kind
of.
I had trouble with this whole thing.
I had an S there anyway.
It didn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, mine too.
Yeah, I got the red S adjustment.
Yeah, I got that too.
And then,
That was the one I put.
And it says, we're coming in with wetlands delineations with snow. And I changed with snow to when snow was on the ground.
Mm-hmm. At a time when snow cover permit, where are you?
I just have a whole,
I think we need to rewrite the
whole paragraph.
Yeah, that one reads
when
awfully funny.
When plans are coming in with wetland delineations.
Yeah.
With snow on the ground. Yep, I gotcha.
When snow was on the ground.
Yeah, when, when snow.
And then after snow,
was.
And this is this is getting relevant picky, but down toward the end of that paragraph, it says zoning regulations, so it would. He actually had a double space between it and would.
Oh, okay, must have been just on the thing, because I didn't.
This one doesn't have it.
No, it's the way it printed out.
Yeah, the next paragraph, the board went over the, it should be hyphenated, off street, off hyphen street. Then hearing no further discussion, comma, a motion was made. And then Chairman Alden asked for the master plan review.
To be.
I put that, the master plan review, to be added. I didn't have to be added.
Yeah, you got it, by the way.
Wait a minute.
Make a motion to.
Hey, you want this?
Accept the minutes as amended.
Markups that I've got.
All in favor?
Aye. You want to pass it to us?
Thank you.
Who seconded that? I was too busy making something.
The next thing on the agenda is review of the master plan. Does anybody object to me just going through this correspondence first?
No.
And then I get rid of this?
Right.
Okay. All right, the first one is the Belmont Planning Board meeting, the public hearing proposed amendments to their zoning ordinance, the plan submission meeting and a public hearing for John O'Connor Sand and Gravel. All right, I'm not sure.
They always send it to me, and I just put it in there in case anybody wants to see it.
I don't think, if anybody wants to see it, it'll be in here.
Okay.
Okay. The next is community planning grants are available. The New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority announces the grant round two in the community planning and grant program. Over 500,000 is available for competitive matching grants to New Hampshire municipalities. Due February 12th. I would think that maybe our friends up on the Peabody that are planning an additional building would want to look at something like this. Peabody?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, never mind. Okay, and that's it. On apartment standards, accessory apartment standards, and things like that. There's money that's available, so.
Oh. Now I know what you're talking about.
Now you know why I said Peabody?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, I thought they had plans, and that's why I said, well, I would think that would be something that they would be interested in looking into, but I don't know. Okay.
Initially, I thought I was thinking of the street.
Oh, Peabody Street.
You mean
apartment
the
complex.
Yeah. Franklin, yeah. New Franklin apartment.
Yeah. Is a Peabody.
Peabody Brown.
Peabody. Okay, I'm so, why am I?
Well, Peabody is fine, but
okay.
Bell Peabody Brown.
Okay. All
right. Yeah, actually, it's called the New Franklin apartment.
That's the company that owns it? Did they change the name from?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Franklin apartment. Actually, they're old apartments. They just call them new.
They need to be upgraded.
They're better than the Franklin ones, though, I think.
Yeah.
They're all the same.
Yeah.
I know, but I don't know. I guess just the ones I've been to, maybe in Franklin, I didn't like as well. I just sort of put the air conditioners in and pick up people. So. Sandy, do you have any update on the CIP? from the police department.
I do.
Yes, we do. Gus got the same thing I did, so. I did bring a message to the selectmen last week, and they asked Joyce to get a hold of the chief and Dennis and
Here, here's all the, here's copies of all the CIP for the police department, if anybody wants to look at it.
Okay, then we have a committee ready to get started.
Yep.
And the only other thing was Dennis submitted his highway, but it's all in one thing. He just did his highway, 10-year highway thing. That's all here. And then Joyce resubmitted the island project that was submitted back in 2008. She's resubmitted that.
But I have a question.
Okay.
When we wrote our impact fee regulations, we have those. But the only thing we have for methodology is police and soon to be highway. We don't really have anything for the island.
This is not impact fees. This is just the CIP.
Okay.
CIP is not the impact fee.
Okay,
right,
so we're not going to be charging fees for it. Just set up a CIP for
right.
it. Okay.
Right.
I have no problem with that.
This is just the CIP.
I just didn't know what she had in mind when she did that.
She had tried to get so that she could get it fixed.
Okay.
We're talking about the retaining walls and all
yes.
that?
Yes.
Yes. Is there any more negotiation between Northfield and Tilton on the island?
Last letter we got from them, they have to put it on their ballot. You know, and I had mentioned, well, instead of trying to take it over altogether, why don't we just reach an agreement that for the time being that Tilton will take care of it, and you know, because they want no part of it. But you know, because for them to sign it, they can't technically, if you read the deed, they can't give it to us. They can't sell it to us. According to the deed, we're both half owners of the property. And if you go against what that says, then technically you have to give the land back to the
heirs.
The heirs. So it was a case to where, well, if they want, they don't want any part of it, then they can just turn the care of the island, you know, over to Tilton. You know, we can reach an agreement for that part of it. But as far as deeding, the only other thing we could do is contact whatever heirs would be left and, you know, see if we could reach an agreement with them that the island could be sold to Tilton and that we would continue doing with it exactly what we're doing now. It would still be an island, we'd take care of it, we'd still have the concerts there. And obviously, anyone and everyone is welcome to be there. You know, it's not like if Northfield gave up control that people from Northfield couldn't use it. This is not the way it would work. So, but anyway, that's the process. But Northfield won't do and can't do anything until town meeting, and they're going to bring it up for discussion. That was the last bit.
Now, if in fact they agreed to the what you just talked about,
right?
Would we seek out the assistance of an attorney to protect us in case we
yes,
spend a lot of money and
right.
then they wanted to?
No, there's no question that okay. if we just, depending on what we find out too, when we try and contact whatever heirs might be left, you know, whether they would be in agreement with the, you know, the fact that Northfield no longer, I shouldn't say Northfield, the selectmen of Northfield are no longer interested in the care of the island. But that doesn't mean that the people of Northfield feel that way. You know, there is a difference. So, if in fact the town voted to, that they say did not care whether they got rid of it or not, then it would have to be an agreement reached with the heirs if it would be all right for them to sell it back, to sell their half to us. Now, if that does in fact happen or it doesn't, even if we have come up with an agreement that we will care for it, then yes, we would have to have an attorney make up this agreement so that, you you know, you don't want to put all that money and work into it, only to say, okay, well, now it's all fixed up, we want it back.
We want it back,
yeah.
Well, that's why I asked.
They can't do like a quick claim on their aspect of ownership, nothing.
See, that's what happened out there with the LLC, the Haven Grove area. That was all owned by, where Haven Grove, where the chiropractor office is now, that was all owned by the Historical Society. The Historical Society, probably to get, I don't know why they did it, maybe they had to pay taxes, and they wouldn't have paid taxes on it because it was a nonprofit.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But at any rate, they said they were never going to use that piece of property.
Yeah.
And they sold it.
And it according to the deed, it had to revert back to the original heirs.
Okay.
It did, and the original heirs, and if you look back through the deed process, because I researched all that, it was so convoluted,
mm-hmm.
so that they had trouble finding the heirs. They were somebody who was married, and the husband died, and it was, as I say, very convoluted.
Right.
And the person that ended up with it immediately sold it to John Bernard.
Right.
Well, see, that's what I'm thinking. If you start looking for these heirs, and God forbid you miss one, then,
back.
Yeah, that will come back because they didn't give up their right to have that property reverted to them.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that would probably call for what they call a quiet title. You know, that's done when you're not, there might be some doubt or not. If you're not sure that you've reached everybody that you should have reached, or if you have trouble finding the heirs, then you put it in a lot of papers around, and it's an announcement. It's what they call a quiet title. And what that really is doing is, if there's anyone out there that reads this, if you have a claim to it, you better come in and speak now. So
it's like Found Money.
Yeah.
That website.
I never find my name on the website.
I
find my name.
Now.
It's just somebody else that has my name.
Yeah. So anyway, it's not that it's
from the state one country.
It hasn't been forgotten. It's just that nothing has been done after the last talk when they were saying they were going to bring it up before their town meeting. So, but it would be something that would be worthwhile. You know, it's like, by the way, we got any further with this, so to find out.
You were going to talk to Al about enforcement of signage?
Yes, we did talk about it, and I also asked Al if he would please. He's going through the zoning right now, the signage section, and he's going to make notes on what works, what's impossible, what we need as far as enforcement. And as far as the flags that you're seeing on Main Street, those are allowed by zoning. They are permitted, but only one per property. Right now we have someone that's violating that because they have two up.
TLC?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, you know.
One per property or one per business on the property? Because there's multiple businesses in some ways.
One per property, according to the zoning. So anyway, so that's, you know, I personally think we need to go back to what was there before, and that was the fact that there weren't, our signage used to read, there was no freestanding signage allowed in the downtown district.
Well, I was going to say,
primarily because of the sidewalks.
That sign is on the town property.
Yes. They've used that hole that was there in the concrete, yes. But anyway, we also need to decide, and I guess to start with the park commissioners first, as far as removing the trees on this side of Main Street. The other side is no issue. They don't have trees, but...
Well, you know, don't you think we should meet with the merchants, do our meeting this spring with the merchants first?
Yes. I really think that it's important that we sit down with the merchants and get their input as far as what they feel signage-wise. I mean, I realize that, you know, for the most part, business wants, you know. I mean, they would have signs on every street corner all over the town.
It'd look like Las Vegas.
But the important thing is, I think they should have a say, and if they feel that the trees are an issue, then I think we should carry it further, because they have gotten a lot bigger. Those were all supposed to be dwarf trees, and maybe they are dwarfs, but some of them are all, you know, getting into the electric lines now, and they are hiding the signage on the front buildings. So, you know, I'm not trying to tell business downtown that you can't do anything. I don't want to be like that. I want to encourage it. But at the same time, we can't have them running amok with some.
Yes. Well, I have brought up the flashing open signs.
Yes.
The next time you drive down Main Street at night, just check them out. I mean, they're, and they are almost, there was one that wasn't flashing.
Yeah.
All the others are flashing.
Well, they need to fix them to where they can't flash. They can have the lights on it. There's nobody is complaining about that. But it's not good when you go through downtown, it's psh, 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 you know, as you drive.
Well, they're all on this side, though.
Yeah.
But are those types of signs not permitted?
The flashing
it's an open sign.
It's not permitted.
It's an open sign, though, is it?
But it's flashing.
It's flashing.
They are allowed an open sign.
Yeah.
They are allowed an open sign.
Maybe Tilt Vegas, by the way.
Tilt Vegas, yeah.
Well, no, it's just not. I guess my question is, yes, there's, like, the signs that change letters aren't supposed to flash, like the big, you know, electronic signs that, you know, the one Squam Auto has, the Smoke and Barley, coming down Route 3. But is an open sign considered one of those signs?
Well, the sign is...
Because I'm sure when those regulations were permitted, those types of signs didn't exist. Those open, flashing open signs seem to be a recent phenomenon.
Well, I think one store had it... I think Polly's is the first
But
one
like you said, they can go into BJ's and buy them. I mean, it's not a big, and they probably do go in and say, let's take one of these. Or Staples even, I think.
But I don't think the permit makes a differentiation between the type of sign other than flashing.
Yeah.
Right. So any kind of flashing sign, regardless of the message, open, you know,
closed,
something on sale.
What's with the sawhorses down in front of the store?
No, the corner
that
store?
That is to keep people from driving in and out off of Route 3.
No, that ingress and egress we talked about a month back.
Yes, okay.
Just they finally make up their mind.
The store owner and the selectman, he came down and visited with the selectman last Thursday, and we met him at his site on and along with the DOT representative. And they have a plan that originally the DOT had come to an agreement that that's what they would want to see. And he was there yesterday and went over everything and then just measured the distance from where the berm will be to the edge of pavement so that, because we still have to get a sidewalk in there. And the DOT would like to see 5 feet from the edge of road to the sidewalk, but Bill Rollins said yesterday that he thought that the DOT would go along with 4 feet, you know, because we have to have a 5 foot walk in there, you know, for wheelchairs. So anyway, that if in fact that is all approved, then we will get the letter or whatever it is from the DOT tomorrow. Are you back?
You're
nice to see you too. Yeah. Merry Christmas, everyone.
You're not on this agenda.
Day without John.
No, he's not. Well, he's not, but he wanted to get some paperwork.
I can just drop it off. I just have a Mylar here that needs to be signed some other time.
I was going to stop by and say Merry Christmas to you today.
Well, that would have been nice. So I have a letter with my name on it. Is that what you showed me?
I was just asking what other stuff
would
be on the
side
one anyway, so you guys can do it.
No,
I don't see
why that would be the only thing I had suggested, Gus told me that you were going to be bringing this in, that you wanted to record your plan.
Right.
The only thing, though, is I don't know that technically we can do it yet, because although we've had one public hearing...
Oh, this isn't regarding that one.
No. Oh, this is the other one?
This is 7 Grange Road.
But isn't 7 Grange Road, isn't part of that, for the sidewalk?
Nope, that was kind of independently got approved. approved.
Okay, it's part of the park.
Parking, but it was not really part of this one.
Okay.
And I read this for other reasons.
Hello.
Hi.
Mike.
All right, well, if you wanna leave it, we'll go over it, and, you know, we just have to make sure everything's in order.
That's fine, I'll just drop it off.
All right.
I had to pick my son up at school anyway, so it's all good.
Okay.
I'll put this back.
If it's in there, where else does it?
You just can't stand not being.
That's right, I didn't wanna have a meeting without me, I felt left out.
John was getting scratched and started twitching. Tuesday night, where should I be?
I know, I keep telling my wife, we're threatening to move, which I do.
If you wanna leave it, pass it, when we get through with this other, we'll take a look at it.
Good.
I'll give you a call tomorrow, John, if it gets signed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Night, all.
Good night.
Night, John. Did you find the open flashings?
I'm looking here at.
I thought it was real specific, I don't have.
Well, there's a couple of them here, it says, signs which physically or visually move, rotate, or create an illusion of movement, or which have parts or services that are physically or visually move, rotate, create the illusion of movement, or which emit audible sound or noise. And then it comes down here, it says wall signs located such that any part thereof, oops, wrong one. Signs which appear animated or projected or which are intermittently or intensely illuminated or of a traveling, tracing, scrolling, or
sequential
light type, or signs which contain or are illuminated by animated or flashing light. These are signs prohibited. So the flashing, the open part can be there and it can be lit, it just can't be flashing.
Question.
Yes.
Are these sign regulations for interior signs or exterior signs?
Doesn't differentiate.
It doesn't differentiate.
I'm just trying to play devil's advocate.
Close to the question.
Yes.
Yeah, because some of them, you're right, they're hanging inside their building.
Because some of these regulations, you know, signs in the windows aren't supposed to cover more than 30%. So I guess it's a definition.
But signs in the windows that are flashing to the outside.
But in some cases it's a technicality that
mm-hmm.
it's not specific to an exterior sign, such as a sign under, I'll use Walgreens for example. You know, that obviously that's different, but this is a sign that's inside of a store, it's, you know, behind glass, if you will.
And but you can see it from the road. And that's, I think, the reason they don't want the signs flashing is because it's a safety issue.
Well, that's an interesting concept in your part. Is there anything specifically saying?
But okay, if I drive by AutoServe, they have stuff that, you know, stuff that advertises inside their inside their store. You know, I can see that from the road. So I guess how, you know, they have TVs that flash advertisements and stuff like that. You know, if you go in there and it's, you go by other.
That's inside, yeah.
That's inside, but it's, I guess it's not street front. It's on the back of the wall.
Right.
You know.
That's
a
good point.
That's the visual from.
You can,
but I can see it from the road.
But it's not intended to be flashing.
Okay, so if I put my open sign in, you know, if I hang it 2 feet from the inside of my glasses,
am I excluded?
Well, that would be something that would have to be contested in court. Let a judge decide, I should think. But
I don't
want to
pay for my expense.
I would think, and I'm going to take someplace that I go a lot, Polly's. She has an open sign on the side, actually. I don't think it faces front.
It's on the side.
It's on the side. Okay, if I'm driving down the street, out of the corner of my eye, that could be distracting, construed as distracting. If she had that same open sign back on her back wall up over where her kitchen is, I wouldn't be distracted by that. If I stopped the car and turned and looked, I could see it, but it wouldn't distract me when I was driving.
If she stopped it flashing, it wouldn't distract you so much. If she just had it solid,
right, just lit.
just lit.
That doesn't, that,
yeah,
that,
would be fine.
Well, the only one that had just a lit sign the other night when I drove down the street was TLC.
Right, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All the others were flashing.
So we could
Okay, I can go and put, I can hang crystal in my windows and that sparkles and reflects. And that would be more of a distraction. So if you're behind somebody in traffic that has one of those stupid things hanging from their rearview mirror, I mean, I don't know, I guess I'm playing devil. I'm not trying to be a jerk, I'm just being devil's advocate.
You're being more than the devil.
You are a little devil.
He comes up with more stuff.
Your mind's always going.
Well,
I was just thinking outside the box. I mean,
you
could wander down that, down that little.
Well,
I mean, if you want to talk about distractions, if you go down Main Street late at night, the cupcake place, they leave their white lights on, and that's distracting. I mean, I guess where do you draw the line of distracting?
And if I've got sneakers that flash and walking down the street, that'll distract you too. Am I out walking the street after a certain hour?
Yeah, you should be.
They don't want you walking
the street. No street walkers.
Yeah.
Well,
we don't have an ordinance against that.
But Judy, you walked down with me that night, remember?
My shoes don't flash.
Okay. You brought up a couple. Somebody brought up a couple.
Oh,
right.
I did. I have a couple. Okay. I actually. Yeah. That type of business isn't allowed. Lakes Region Cupcakes, I've observed, has temporary signs. One near the entrance to Market Basket off of, I guess, when you come
Market Street.
Yeah, I don't know if it's Market Street that loops all the way around.
Yeah,
to
Market
the other
Street's
end.
The one that goes across the front of Walmart.
No, not that really, yeah, but it loops up around where if you're coming off
Sherwood Drive.
No, the other side where there's no traffic light.
Right.
There's a sign there, and then also at the entrance to the diner, into that plaza there, they also have a sign that specifically says, one says 1.3 miles, the other one says 2 miles. And it has an arrow.
Yeah,
and then also for Canterbury Shaker Village, there's also signs at the end of Route 140.
Well, even when you
and
think about it,
Paris Nails is all over. Paris Nails had one. I thought they were running for office.
I know that, for instance, if a realtor had a property for sale out on Manville Road, and I'm picking Manville Road because I used to work there, they would put a sign out at the beginning of Manville Road, and the property was in the back, way in the back there. That's off-premise signage as well. And I know that Guilford cracked down on that.
Yeah. Well, nothing more disgusting than to be going down and you come to this intersection and there's like 14 for sale, house for sale signs with arrows pointing all different directions. And it's like...
Well, and we also get signs at the beginning of Sanborn Road for what's going on in Sanborn. Heritage Farm and all that.
Right. And also I noticed that, what was his name, the guy that was running, I keep thinking Olaf or the Sultan.
Ovid.
No, not Ovid.
Yusuf.
Yusuf. He has signs all over the place. He's still his
Ovid
still has.
And he should
be in violation of state law.
Yeah, and Samardin, I saw baths all over the place still.
Yeah, I know, Colby Road.
I was just going to say Colby Road's use of all over the place.
Yeah. There's a lot of.
And there are Romney ones too, I've noticed in certain places.
Yeah.
People just don't go.
They're all still
out. You had mentioned one time that the Black Swan Inn didn't have a temporary sign permit for that big yellow sign.
They do now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she came in and got it.
So, but anyway,
so it's just
I think these are all the kind of things that we need to write down to. You bring
but
up
he's
a
not
good
retired.
Point. If it's flashing inside the store, does that matter? I mean, although I think this has been written as an all-inclusive, it doesn't specify indoor or outdoor. It does talk a little bit about windows, but, when it says, for businesses in the downtown district, signage will be restricted to 20 square feet to be located on the facade or attached perpendicular to the facade of the building. The following restrictions apply. Animated moving signs are prohibited. awnings or canopies may not extend over two-thirds of the sidewalk or 6 feet from the building face, whichever is lesser. And any lettering on the on canopies or awnings will be considered part of the total signage. Now, 20 square feet is not really a big sign. It can be like 2 by 10.
It's a 4 by 5.
Or 4 by 5.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I mean, but some of the businesses I noticed downtown, they have their main sign, but then they got all these other signs all over the place too, and it's really getting a little bit carried away. But I think once we sat down with them and we work with them, you know, hear what they have to say, and we'll consider what they have to say when we're rewriting this whole thing, you know, for signage.
Well, I have a question in my mind about what you just read in regards to the perpendicular sign,
mm-hmm.
which now allows for two faces.
Right.
Are you allowed just 10 square feet per face or 20 square feet per face, which gives you 40 square feet of total
right.
signage?
I know it does, but generally speaking, in the other districts, if you have a sign that the face is on both sides, it's only counted as if it's at, say, 40 square feet,
mm-hmm.
but it's just two-sided. That's how it
yeah.
was always done in the past. I don't know whether this still talks about that or not. The old signage regulations did, but...
Well, I think one of the things is... that we should do is making sure everything is that the way we treat people is consistent.
Yes, I do too.
And I'm thinking back, and it was when I first came on the planning board with Walmart. We made Walmart go through jump through hoops with different kinds of designs.
Yes, we did.
And yet we allow other businesses because they're more popular, well, they're local as opposed
right.
to a big box company that everybody hates,
mm-hmm.
you know. But we the planning board really made them jump through hoops. Remember, they had to come up with all those new designs,
right?
So I think we need to, you know, what's sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander,
right?
And we can't just pick and choose.
No,
like we, you know, we can complain about the cupcake lady having signs, sandwich boards. Well, Home Depot has sandwich boards from what, the time you go past Wendy's Inn.
Right.
They're all over the place.
A lot of people now have signs.
Enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, this is part of it. But unfortunately, we're sitting here with a signage regulation that in some areas you sit there and even though you read it, you go, what? You know, I mean, it's been, how do I say this and not be unkind? This was written by attorneys, and it was left so that if a town or a community didn't like something, there was, you know, enough
wiggle room.
Yes, that they could have something to go after. Nowhere in here is there really anything on enforcement, you know, so that's another issue. You know, you can threaten and yell and do anything, you know, all day long, but if you don't have anything to back you up,
no teeth.
It has no teeth. So this is why I say I really feel strongly that there's a lot of stuff in here that if we were a city might be pertinent, but we're not.
And that's because it was taken right from Concord.
Yeah, this is Concord signage, right? There's no question about that. So what I'm saying to you is we sit down and we write our own and we take, maybe there's parts of this that we do want. You know, I know that we don't want flashing and running signs and stuff like that. I can appreciate that. There's, we come up with a signage that works for our town. I guess that's really, in my mind, you need to simplify it a little bit more so that when people read it, there's no interpretations. There's just one way to interpret it, you know. And then we have something in there about enforcement.
And what happens if they
and
don't comply?
Yes. And if you don't
deadlines.
Comply,
what happens
what
now? Someone doesn't comply.
Well, I was going to say, in the meantime, he doesn't have to enforce them. All
no,
these
no.
ones we've discussed.
He. Well, I know he's in the process of writing letters again.
Do we have fines in this town? Do they have fines?
No, that's what we were saying. There's
yeah,
not.
Sandy. Even so, and I agree. Doing that. You've got to rewrite them so that there are cutoffs, deadlines,
yes,
and
right.
You know, and no No grandfathers, no, oh, well, you had a sign before, we'll leave it there.
Well.
Cut that off.
But what gets you in trouble is a lot of the signs around town that you would prefer that not be there are there by variance. And when I say
can't
that
do
they're.
Can't do anything about those.
No, and they're there forever.
Right.
That variance, even if the business closes, the variance is still there. So whoever mm-hmm. moves in next is entitled to the same thing that those variants got the one before.
But I think we have a lot of non-compliant signs that weren't granted by a variant.
Exactly, and those can be saying,
a lot
oh, okay,
of them were.
If Mary's Sweatshop has a flashing, we're open sign, then by December 31st, 2014, that has to be gone.
Yeah.
And done.
Yeah.
That has to be in there too. I mean, you got to put the deadline.
There is a section in here.
10 years to come into it.
That is for lighting.
Oh, is that for lighting? I
yeah.
thought there was something
no,
for the
signage,
too. No,
that's for the lighting.
Too.
For the dark
it's
sky.
So much of the sign.
They're supposed to come in compliance for 10 years. I don't know how that's
yeah.
going to be enforced, but.
Yeah. But how do you enforce that? How do you prove it's been 10 years?
That's come out of New Mexico.
What is that?
The dark,
New Mexico or dark sky.
The dark skies.
Yeah, the dark skies.
Sky protection. All lighting installations must be brought into compliance with the provisions of this chapter within 10 years of its effective date.
But I thought, wasn't there something in the signage too that if you take down more than so much of a percent that you can't put it back up?
If a non-conforming sign shall be placed only with a sign that is in conformance with the provisions of this ordinance.
Hmm.
I thought there was something in there.
Well, I think that's what Eric just kind of read.
Read it louder, Eric.
This is on page 16. Removal, C, removal. If the non-conforming sign is removed, it shall be replaced only with a sign that is in conformance with the provisions of this ordinance, and deconstruction and reconstruction, should the non-conforming sign be destroyed by any means to an extent of more than 75% of its replacement cost at the time of its destruction, it shall not be reconstructed except in conformity with the provisions of this ordinance.
See how hard that is to read?
But unfortunately what happened is, I know I wasn't working with the town at the time, but you know, AutoServe needed to replace one of their signs because the whole base had rusted and whatnot. And you know, we were contacted about it, the fact that they couldn't replace the sign. And I said, but no, you can't do that. Because if you look in their assessing file, there's a variance there for pretty much every sign that's on the AutoServe block.
And now it's all in one place.
Yeah, yeah, so it's the case to where it really doesn't matter.
Even if Mother Nature
like
takes them down, they can be replaced.
But I don't know, did Alan to go over and look at that sign that they've moved up higher in the building and now slanted it towards the road?
The Jumbotron?
I don't know.
It's blinding. Yes, after Eric
Actually, the last few nights when I've come home and it's been foggy, so it almost seems like it's been toned down just a little bit.
I think I kind of discussed it with Al, but whether he's gone over and done mm-hmm. anything about it or
yeah.
not, I don't know.
Like the other night, it was kind of misty and foggy out, and it didn't seem as bright.
Well,
I mean, you can still see it in the sky.
Yeah,
it's coming down the hill.
I've asked about the sign on Agway, and I was told that they had permission to do that.
They did get a permit.
But how can they have
a
permit? How can they have a permit for off-premise? That's off-premise signing.
I don't know, Jerry. I just know that there is a permit.
But it is.
So if somebody walks in and asks for a permit, even if it's an illegal permit, we grant it.
If I want to put a sign on my house for a business up at exit 20, I mean, that's...
You come in and get a permit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if it's because they own it. I don't know what was
but
because
what would that have to do with owning it?
I don't know if at that time they were thinking of putting the vote.
I mean, off-premise signage is off-premise signage, whether you own it or you don't own it.
All right.
I don't know. I didn't
the
issue the permit.
It's on their building.
Yeah, but we're talking about the Agway building.
The Agway building belongs.
Oh, okay, the Agway.
Yeah, the Agway building does belong to the
I was told it was because, and this made no sense to me, but because it makes no sense to me, I can't argue about it. Well, it's because it's a dot-com business.
What's that got to do with it?
A selectman told me that.
It's a dot-com business?
Because it says on
there's nobody in the building.
I'm just telling you what I was told.
But there's nobody in the building.
I'm just telling you what I was told.
That doesn't even make sense.
No, it doesn't.
Is it?
But I would.
The variance wouldn't carry from auto serve on one side of the street to the other side.
No.
It's just for the piece of land.
And auto serve did not own that at that time.
Yes, they did.
Yes, they did.
When they put that sign up, they did.
No.
When they put that .com up there, they owned the building.
When the variance was granted to auto serve, they did not own that piece of property. That's what I'm saying.
No.
So the variance wouldn't have carried with that piece of property at all.
It wouldn't go across the street anyway.
That's what, that was my point.
With the land.
Yeah. No, there's no variance for over there for signage.
So why is it there?
Yeah, so why is it there?
I don't know why it's there.
Because nobody went and complained.
I don't know if at first it was told to Al that they might put the Volkswagen.
Yeah, but they haven't done it yet, so they're jumping the gun.
No, the Volkswagen, they built it.
Yeah, I know.
They built the Volkswagen into the far right of the building.
Yeah, they did.
But they altered the front of that building.
So I have no idea. I don't know what they're doing.
Okay, is any other discussion on anything before we get into the review of the master plan?
Right.
We do have another piece to, Sandy, do you want to go over this?
Which one is that?
The one with the Tucker Bay.
Oh, okay. Yep, I will.
Tucker Bay or Tucker Bay?
Tucker.
Tucker Bay.
Oh, man.
All right. This is a letter that is from Lauren Martin. And I'll just read it to you because she explains what happened and what she's looking for from the planning board. It says, I have met with Nick Pinzano at his request as I had assessed for the first time the convertible land at the condominium. This is the Tucker Bay condominiums. And when he site planned, all the buildings that were on there were site planned. It was a condo subdivision. So it was all the buildings that were there, and he had a little bit of land left at the top of the hill. And he said, I'd like to leave that convertible land that I can put two more units up there if I so desire.
Which piece of property is this?
And so we're...
It's the one beyond where that roadway in, you cross the causeway and it's the next one on the left.
Right, you know where that roadway in is?
Where the
you know where Lynn near?
The jet skis and all that, and it goes up the hill, and it's all white buildings.
That's South Bay.
It's just you know where Nick's house is.
Oh, where the green buildings
are? Right, there's a green house and tan.
And right at the base is the Lynnmere condos. There is a little
looks like an old motel, but it's a condo.
Yeah, an old motel. It was the Lynnmere motel.
Right.
But anyway, back up behind that.
Behind that, so you can't really see it from the road.
No, there's a good-sized house, and it's got like
green
arches
Victorian
on the porch, you know.
It's Nick's house.
It's a green Victorian.
Well, I don't know who Nick is.
It's a green Victorian.
Right.
Okay.
It's beautiful. All then behind it, there's a little
tan cottage. So it's the South Bay, his house, and then the Lynnmere's over here.
Right.
Okay, got it.
So anyway, go on with the letter. A convertible land at the condominium. He had indicated to me on my site visit that although he retained rights to the convertible way, there is no way he could build on this area due to planning and zoning requirements for road frontage, setbacks, slope, etc. Upon my return to the office, I reviewed the plan on file that clearly shows the convertible land and the building setback. It is an approved condominium, and the minutes clearly indicate he has the rights to build two additional units on the convertible land. I could see no reason why he would be prevented from doing so. Mr. Canzano will be filing an abatement on the convertible land he had, as he is adamant this area could not be built upon due to the planning zoning requirements. In preparation for the abatement, I wanted to seek an opinion from the planning board based on the requirements in place if Mr. Canzano would be permitted to build on the convertible land if he wanted to. It appears there is sufficient room for the driveway between the garage and the setback line, and there is a fairly flat area behind the garage to accommodate another unit without having to deal with further development into the slope. He indicated due to a lack of road frontage, slope, and the road requirements, he would not be able to do it. If you could review and get back to me as soon as possible so that I will best be able to respond to Mr. Canzano's allegations. So now I want to show you the plan so that you have a better understanding.
So he can build on it, but he wants to not build on it so he can not pay as much taxes on it. Okay, so does he want to give up that right to build on it?
The little hatched area at the very top is what he's calling convertible land. And you can see where the other units are, and they were existing units already there. Okay, now I want to read from you to you from the minutes.
What's the date on those minutes?
2003, September 2003. Okay, Casey Hayes from Eric Mitchell Associates gave a brief description of the property, which included the existing six buildings, and stated the owner of the property was looking to turn the buildings into condominiums. Mr. Hayes stated that each individual building had unit boundaries, and the back of the property was designated as convertible land. Mr. Hayes continued by saying each of the units was connected separately to the municipal sewer, and there was on-site wells. Ms. Jackson asked if there would be any new paving or structures and was told there would not be at the present time. George Helwig asked if the setbacks were grandfathered on the building too and was told the building was an existing structure. Ms. Jackson asked what the convertible land was and was told there it was there in case the condominium development wanted to expand in the future. Philip Hastings, Mr. Canzano's attorney, stated the convertible land gave the owners the flexibility for future possible development of two more units subject to planning and zoning board approvals. Mr. Hastings stated they did not know if it would be feasible or not with the current regulations, but it would preserve the option in the condominium documents and was necessary to do so, otherwise the owner would lose the option to do it. And then it goes on to talk about other things. But I thought what was important, and that's why it was put in the minutes this way, was Mr. Hastings' comments. It was like they were doing it. They didn't know whether it would be permitted or not, and he can't just do it without coming back to the board. He has to come back in. Right at this present time, he makes a statement, road frontage. Road frontage would not count because he's already got two entrances, an entrance and exit onto the Route 3. And as you can see from here, he could come right in an existing one and go right up behind. Mm-hmm. From either side, really. He could go, well, he couldn't on this side. But he certainly could on this side and run right across. So he could have a unit here and a unit over there. The only thing I don't know, we did get copies of the topos for the area. But I was having a great difficulty because the topos are so small, even though I tried to blow them up some, to find out what the actual, what, you know, the grade in the back was. And of course it isn't shown on the plan. So I don't know if any of you are very good.
It is very high, but I don't know. It's almost like a mountain going at, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's a pretty steep incline.
Can you see those minutes again, Cindy?
So I guess the question comes down to, I mean, obviously if he decided he wanted to put two more units up there, he would be required to come in and do a site plan or what we call an amended. Because right now they aren't, he only has the option for convertible land, meaning that in the future they could potentially put two more units up there if they got planning and zoning approval.
I guess it would also depend on things he brought up, like setbacks, and those are things that can change.
It would be like
they can
right
change,
here.
But right now the all of that, if he were coming in tomorrow, all of the regulations that are in place when this was approved are pretty much in place at the current time.
So we haven't done any changing on any of those since 2000.
No, we have to understand when you're dealing with condominiums, condominiums are kind of one of those things the state says you will approve it.
Yeah.
There's very little that you can do to stop it. So there you have a few options, minor little options for the most part. If they jump through all the hoops and do everything that the state RSA say they have to do, then you can't really deny them.
So what he wants is to change that so he's not taxed on that.
Well, my thought was if he doesn't want to pay taxes on the convertible land, because right now the potential is there that he could build on it. Whether we would allow it to happen or not would strictly depend on kind of a plan he brought us. You know, what he planned on putting up there. How much of the area is he talking about putting huge homes up there, or, you know, small. I mean, how can we say you can or you can't?
I don't see how we can either.
Everything in here says that he's going to come to us for anything he proposes
right.
to do there. So if he wants to throw another shack here or there for rental property, he still has to come to us.
Right.
If he wants to throw a mansion up there, he has to come to us.
It sounds like he wants to eat his cake and keep it too, in regards that he probably wants to maintain that as convertible land, but he
right.
doesn't want to have to pay the tax.
He probably, I think when he put the, in 2003, that's what he wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not
never,
sure that's what
was,
he wants
it
to
it
do.
It was not taxed.
It was not taxed.
It was not taxed, and 997 Laconia Road, Shady Grove condo, one of his condo owners brought up the fact that there was convertible land out there and wanted to know about it, and when Lauren looked into that, that wasn't taxed, so she taxed that convertible land. And then Nick came in and he says, oh, I have convertible land at the other one too. And
right.
She says, oh, really? So then she started taxing them on that one because it hadn't been taxed.
So what's the problem? I don't understand what
he
we're trying to
discuss.
He doesn't
want to put taxes on it.
He says that because of what's going on, yeah, he can't build on it. Today's regulations.
So if he wants to give it up as convertible land, that's his choice.
Well, this is how I feel. If you don't want to pay additional taxes on the potential of putting two more units up there, then you come in and you say, I'm giving up the convertible land. This is
exactly.
a condominium, and so I don't want to be taxed anymore on it.
Exactly.
But I mean, it's just like up the road, you know, where the roadway and the homes that are going up in the back. He pays a percentage of taxes on every one of those units. He was approved for 80, and he pays a percentage of taxes on
480.
For 80 units.
Even though he hasn't built 80.
Right. So, although obviously the tax on each of those 80 units is not the same as it would be on the finished units that are being lived in, it's still, he has the approval. It is, the land has been improved on paper to the point to where, you know, if he could turn around and sell it, anyone could come in and build those 80 units, or 70, I guess now, whatever he's got up there, I don't know. So, and the same would be here. She is taxing him on the improvement that he's done to the lot. It is the improvement he got, the approval he got from the board said, yes, you have convertible land, you have the potential for two more units up there, but you will be required to return for an amended site plan.
So if he doesn't exercise his option to put more units in there, then he has either the option to take it off.
Right.
Or leave it on.
Or leave it on, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, which way do you want to go? Make a choice and be done with it.
But he is paying, there is a tax on the approval because he has the potential, if you will, if he were to sell this, he now has 6 units with the potential for 2 more, or 8 total units. So to sell that property, he can sell it with the idea in mind that you can have 8 units on that property.
Then continue to pay taxes on the potential that you may be able to expand to
right.
sell it for the expansion and maybe later on. But where is that anybody's issue but his own? Like, the option's his and his alone.
Right, and if he wants to move forward with it, there's nothing saying, he's saying he can't do it because of...
He doesn't have the road frontage, blah, blah, blah. He,
right.
He gave all kinds of excuses that didn't make any sense.
But it doesn't...
No, it doesn't make sense at all.
No.
He already has his...
He already has the road frontage.
Entrances,
yeah.
His DOT
yeah. sure.
entrances
right.
for the units.
So if he wants to expand it and pay the taxes on it,
but
you don't want to expand
units,
it, don't expand
have to
it
go
pay
back
the taxes.
For... driveway
no.
permit?
No, because it's already been
no,
permitted
for
the whole unit up there.
It, when they did the permit, was it for 8 units or was it for 6?
Even if it were for 6, all he would have to do is what they call file an updated.
Right.
Yeah.
And they don't charge for that, and all that does is let DOT know that, oh, they're putting 2 more units up there. They just like to keep track of what's on each curb cut.
Mm.
You know, and there are times, like with... Business Park Drive, if you will. There is a number on that driveway curb cut. If they go over X number of cars per day, then they have to put in a turning lane. You know, that was the agreement when DOT issued that curb cut. So, Mr. Nickerson knows that as the park develops, after he has X number of lots that are developed, then he has to put in a turning lane off of 132 to go into the Business Park Drive. And they just keep track of it, and that way if you start getting accidents in an area, they look at things like that. What is the, you know, how many are going in and out?
So what it boils down to is he's just assuming that it's would be unbuildable. The town of Tilton did not tell them that
right, we
it's
do
unbuildable.
Not, right, we do not have steep slopes ordinance. I know there's one running around, but I did quite a bit of research and I can't see where the town ever approved it. So, you know, and this came along after I left and I went to all the town meetings. And so right now we have no steep slopes, approved state steep slopes ordinance of any kind. He's already got 2 units up there, as you can see here. And so I don't know what's over here. I haven't walked the property, but over in here is fairly flat. I remember him talking about that. So there's no reason that he couldn't put a unit there. And depending if he brought this driveway up like this, he could come around and go right across the back of these and have, you know.
Doesn't he fall into... the distance of a driveway and the rules we put in for driveway requirements, if there's X number of feet of access, it had to be up to DOT grade. I think we did something to that effect like 3 or 4 years ago.
The only thing that's on there is if a driveway is over, I think it's 1,000 feet, or maybe it's 500, I can't remember now, that it has to be approved by the fire department. It has to be able to support emergency vehicles coming to your site for fire medical emergencies.
That was a change. Even when Avatar was looking to develop the property on Jocelyn Lane, the 10 acres there, we made some changes to the driveway permitting. And what would be a driveway would...
Oh, that was a road. That's a road. That's a.
That was
that's
also
a
that was a road. There is a regulation in our subdivision regulations on the roadways. It says you cannot have a dead end road over so many feet long, and that would have been a dead end road. It didn't go anywhere.
This isn't going anywhere, and it's.
Yeah, but this is all part.
That's a Bulver Drive.
And you also have the other rule that says that one driveway can only service 2 dwellings. And he would not be serving more than 2 dwellings off of that particular driveway. He would come in this entrance, but it would go straight up and over.
Mm-hmm. Well, as long as it doesn't cut into somewhere else.
Right. So, you know, like here, you can see this driveway comes up and it services these two units here. Mm-hmm. And actually, he's got it circling back around and coming back out.
This is actually a garage.
Yes. Okay, so servicing this house. Now, and he's got a carport here. There's a
little circle.
These is over here.
Is there enough room to put a driveway through there without getting into the setback? Or?
It's like all of this is.
Yeah. Existing paved and parking, right.
Well.
All I'm saying is, unless he comes in to where you have an idea of what it is he wants to do, that he says he can't do, we don't know that for a fact.
Yeah. And right here is, he's got to come before us with any adjustments anyway before he can't
do
anything
without. But what he's wanting to do is he's wanting to keep convertible land for the potential of expansion, but he, because of the taxes now being charged, he's saying he can't build on it. Mm-hmm. So I'm saying if you truly feel that way and you don't want the additional taxes, give up the convertible land. Mm-hmm. That way, the tax on the value of the convertible land will go back because then it just becomes part of the condo. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the way I would look at it. It's kind of like I get the feeling he wants a day to need it too. So,
this is Nick.
Yeah.
How much tax difference is there on convertible land or just unused land? And this is 0.79 acres.
Let me see if there's something on.
I'm just curious because it's like.
You have a tax card there, Sean?
I got that.
I think the tax card's available.
Didn't you put the tax card?
It's important. It's not really important. It's just curiosity.
Well, I was going to look on the tax card and see.
It is the consideration that that's causing him to get it.
Got his attention.
Well, it was right on the outside.
Well, if convertible land is valued at $50,000 and an unbuildable land is worth
$25,000.
Right. But then he doesn't pay the tax. He's got to figure it out.
I don't know what I can do.
I don't know. Maybe I didn't. I don't know if I put it there or not.
Okay.
I might not have done it.
Okay. I'm not seeing it.
Yeah. I don't think I did it. I didn't think that would be a question.
So I don't know, without looking at the assessment card, I don't know.
Curiosity factor.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could probably pull one out if I get on the one there and pull it.
It's not that important.
No.
At this point, it's not really germane to.
So what should I tell Lauren?
Well, I think we all kind of agree that if he wants it to stay that way, if in fact he feels that it can't be built on, then there's no point in leaving it as convertible land. Mm-hmm. You know, that would be one way to eliminate the possibility of taxes. For us to sit here and speculate on whether he can or he can't build there, considering we don't have any idea what he might have in mind, without seeing it, we're not going to know.
And it's the property right behind his house, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes, back up
and
behind his
see,
house.
And see, I've been up there, and I think it's just woods.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, he has a garden up there.
Yeah.
And then it's just woods. It's like it goes way up.
Yeah. So.
But if he didn't want to build, then he'd need to come back to the board.
Oh, yeah.
Amended site plan because nothing in our regulations states that he can't build there.
Correct.
Right now, there's nothing that says he can't build there. It could be that maybe the steepness of the slope is too severe, that he would have to cut into the slope to reduce the steepness of it. I don't know.
But we don't know that.
No, right. We know. So we'd have, but there's nothing in our regulations that will stipulate that he can't build. At this point, he has to have to come back to the board for amended site plan, right?
Right. So no matter what, even if he decides, you know, I'm not really sure I understand, you know, other than the fact that, you know, even his own attorney said, you know, they don't know if it's there, but they wanted to maintain that right in the future. But, you know, this is the way our system is taxed. Now, he's certainly welcome to go through the abatement process. It doesn't mean that he's going to get an abatement, but, you know, he could certainly go that route. But I think what Lauren is looking for now was just the input from the board on how they felt about it.
Yeah, because he said that of all those regulations, you know, the road frontage and everything, there's nothing in the regulations stipulating that he couldn't move forward.
Right.
Okay.
I don't think there is. You know, I kind of wonder.
But he would need to do a site. I'll just put that in.
Oh yeah, he'd have to do an amended site plan. That's right. In minutes.
With plans.
You know, you could even if you wanted to. Well, of course, you're not really sending him anything.
No, I'm just giving
this to
Lauren.
You're just getting it for him.
Lauren.
But you know, keep that the minutes there where it does say that he would have to come back in.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I'll give her a copy of that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. There's nothing else then. Let's get to the master plan.
Okay, well, when we're done with there, I never got any input from anybody on the setbacks or the parking. So after we do the master plan, if we could talk about that. Because that has to be resolved, too, so we can have a public hearing in January.
I did have a question on both the parking and the setbacks.
All right, well,
I have a copy of the revised natural resource chapter with the section added that we put in, if anybody wants copies of that.
No, thank you. Okay.
And that's just the natural resource chapter that...
Yeah.
What is this?
This is, remember we changed, we made two additions to the natural resources.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
And it's just I added it. And
that's where the changes are.
And I kind of highlighted on in there, it's under the wetlands section, and I highlighted
right.
where it is.
Comments?
Well, I was going to say there's, although we did go through a total of three chapters, the rest we haven't gone through and, you know, to make sure of any corrections. All we did was the natural resources, we did land use, and I believe.
I thought we did community facilities.
I was going to say, I thought we did too. I was just looking to see. Yes.
That's what I have.
So we've done those, but we haven't done, we did transportation.
I was going to say, we did vision statement, community facilities, transportation, and natural resources. Those are the ones I thought we did.
Yeah. So that still leaves, what about the economics and demographics?
I do.
Transportation, division statement we did.
Yep.
Did we? I'm looking to see if
I have it checked off as we did.
Well, because I didn't show any corrections at all or any changes to it. That's why I didn't know.
Were there changes to the other chapters? Because I want to find out that or not.
I know we did transportation. I've got mine all marked up with the changes.
Oh, okay, so I haven't got the changes yet.
Okay, and then land use. I know we did that. I made those.
See, I don't have that one, so.
You don't have land use?
No.
The very first, it's like this, land use. We corrected it, I know we did.
Okay, maybe, I don't know, maybe it's in some other file I have.
Yeah.
You want another one, Jane?
Yes,
I got
please.
More copies here.
Yeah.
Don't have it. All of them, but I have.
So, you know, I don't know.
Here's a land use one.
Not that
I'm not
trying.
Sure what the change is.
Not that I'm trying to, spread this out to more time, but, maybe we, what we need to do is go through one more time, make any corrections that we see, especially like to economic and demographics, because I don't think we went through that one at all. I went through this, I didn't have any marks of any kind. This was the last chapter that she sent us.
What one?
Economics and demographics. You know, and there's just nothing, no marks at all in it.
I don't know if we did it or not.
But anyway, if we go through it at least once, if everybody goes through each chapter, highlight anything you don't like or cross it out, whatever, and then we go through it one more time, that way at least we can set up a public hearing, get that done. And at the end of the public hearings, then we can vote to adopt, and then we can give this a printing amount.
Okay.
That's really all we have, you know.
And so we can plan on that for the next meeting, Gus.
Right. Okay. Final master plan review?
Yeah.
Yes.
So that we can...
And then the next one we can have the public hearing.
Right, the one after that, you mean, yeah.
Okay.
We do have some references to state descriptions.
Yeah, that one,
yeah, that one.
Yeah, but we this could go in, they said, we put a note on that, that could go into zoning.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to have that in, and we need to put that in the zoning somewhere, right?
Yeah, well, that's where it would go.
Yeah.
But we haven't really reviewed the steep slopes chapter, you know, that proposed. We haven't looked at it, nothing. So, you know, it's just been floating around with most...
For years, I guess.
Yes, but with the master plan stuff, and it really doesn't belong in the master plan.
This is what
Sarah had sent me. This is an appendix. That's what
it's
I showed as an appendix.
Appendix to... I don't know what. This is what Sarah sent me when she redid the master, when she had the master
plan.
But
even if you put it in as an appendix, there's absolutely nothing in our zoning or anything to support it. You know, and it's, the master plan is there.
Well, where did it come from?
Sarah had it when we were working on the master plan before. She always had this in the steep slope in there with just the X's that they didn't give an appendix number yet. And I'm not sure where it was supposed to go.
I mean, I have no problem with if the board wants to have a steep slope thing. I mean, you know, but I think...
But I don't understand. This is like...
The only thing it could be an appendix of would be the natural history chapter. That's the only thing, I mean, the...
Natural resource chapter.
Yeah, the natural.
And it could be an appendix to that.
Because it does kind of touch on the lands and the resource inventories, and I do recall reading something where they're talking a little bit about
steep slopes.
Steep slopes, but.
Yes, in the natural resource chapter, there's a section on steep slopes.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I thought, okay, that this was a part, originally, of what the Conservation Committee had done when Sarah was trying to upgrade it. And
yeah.
What we have is what they want.
I have no idea.
That's what my, that was my understanding, that,
yeah.
According to what Kathy Mitchell said.
Oh,
really?
Okay.
Yeah.
I know
this has been with it since I started.
Well, then why don't we review that chapter as well, the steep slopes, if we want
to
make it an appendix
to
the
natural
plan, of the natural resources. But we have
okay,
to
let's
through.
Review this, though, because
yes.
This makes no sense to me.
Just,
right.
On the,
because it says here, the goal is to ensure that land with steep slopes is developed in a way to minimize negative environmental impact. The planning board should encourage developers to protect.
Right.
I think that's why we send them to the conservation if there's a question. That's just my own feeling.
Right.
But let's review this.
Yep.
in conjunction with the natural resources and see what.
Right.
If we can see it, I think there's steep slopes in the natural resources.
It is, it's right here, it's section F.
Yeah.
So it may very well be an appendix for that chapter.
That's what I thought.
Would you open a can of worms?
But I think we need to go over.
No, if you look under natural resources section of the master plan, there's a section on steep slopes.
Right.
There is, yeah.
Yep.
The accessibility of fire apparatus, emergency equipment, is a substantial problem, yeah, it goes on and on about it.
Yeah.
So let's review that as well. You know, because I haven't even read it.
And I'm gonna put natural.
I don't think this, we should even be, I don't think this is even goes with the revision, this, I don't, I think this, I'll check with Kathy.
I didn't send that to her to review, the steep slopes.
The who?
Kathy Mitchell. I haven't sent that, I didn't send that to you.
Yeah, but she has the steep slopes, they rewrote what?
Oh, I know they rewrote it.
They didn't, they completely rewrote it.
Yes, I know they did.
All right, well, why don't you check with Kathy, in the meantime, we'll read it and go over it.
Okay.
And, because, I mean, it's one thing to put it in the master plan, but there's really nothing in our regulations to support it. So if we do that, I mean, it's there and it's words, and a master plan is a guide, but it's not law. So, you know, we can always start out there, there's nothing saying that next year at this time, we can't be reviewing, you know, something for the zoning on steep slopes. That's certainly a doable thing.
Off-street parking.
Okay, next.
Well, I just wanted to talk to everybody about this off-street parking and the setback, the section to put into the zoning, talking about the setback a little bit.
I didn't bring one.
So, I need feedback, nobody gave me any, so I don't know.
Well, I thought the standard for a parking space was 9 by 19. Generally accepted setback.
9 by 19 and 9 by 18?
9 by 19, 9 by 19.
Okay, so instead of 10?
Yeah, I'm just going based on what I've always experienced. I always thought it was 9 by 19, but I don't know.
I thought you could.
It can vary.
I was gonna say, I thought that you could determine that, you know. I didn't think there was any set rule.
I think, except our regulation, off-street parking does specifically say a parking space shall be, which says it will be.
Yeah.
10 by 20, so you.
But I mean, what I'm saying is I didn't think there were set ones that we had to use. I thought we could determine that.
Right.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, then I think we need to rewrite that. You can say a parking space can be from 9 by 19 up to 10 by 20. I mean, in some cases, if it were a warehouse and they're putting in parking spots for semi-trailer trucks, obviously they're going to be a lot bigger.
Yeah.
Well, then that would be down there, but I think a general parking space for a passenger vehicle is going to be 9 by 19. I know that's what Haven Grove, the employee parking lot, you know, that was specifically listed there as 9 by 19, and that's what we kind of use as a standard for that.
Well, we can certainly make it 9 by 19. We can always, why don't we say, I hate to leave it.
Well, why can't we say can vary from? Can we say that?
How about parking place sizes can vary, but generally they are.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about that.
It puts a loophole in there.
It puts, exactly. Mm-hmm. Define it. Anything else is an exception.
Then a parking space shall be 9 by 19. What if somebody wants to put them in a little bit bigger?
Then let them come before CBA and ask them.
Yeah.
Establish it.
Put no more than, okay?
Yeah.
Parking space shall be no more than 10
establish
by 20.
Minimum.
Here's
less than.
Here's an example from another town.
Okay.
A parking space shall be not less than 8 by 18.
Yeah, less than.
Okay, so why are we saying not less than 9 by 19?
9 by 19.
Okay, parking place shall not,
shall be not less than.
Shall less than 9 by 19.
Why don't we say the minimum allowable space for parking?
Because someone's gonna ask, well, you didn't say anything about more than, you just said less than.
Well, they can make them as big as they want.
Yeah.
Yeah, they can make them bigger.
If they can fit 10 of the 9 by 19s in a space, if they don't wanna put two in there, that's...
If you got Bob's Cadillac.
Yeah. Well, the other thing is, what if everybody's running around in that, what's that little car called?
A smart car.
If you got a smart...
You can park that on a postage stamp.
But two of those.
But it's safe. Did you see the design of it?
Yeah, I've seen that commercial on the internet where they got a big, heavy truck sitting on top of one.
Time.
But I still wouldn't want to be in one.
They're so light. What happens when you're doing 70 down a highway and a big semi-trailer truck goes around you?
Or a big wheel.
You're going to leave in the wind.
You're going to go blowing.
They have to follow National Highway Traffic Safety Board regulations, I'm sure. There's certain ones.
Don't you remember Volkswagens with the engines in the rear end? Do you know how many of those flipped over?
Yeah.
Because there was no weight in front of them?
About you, but I've driven a smart car.
And I hit the back of a Cadillac in a Volkswagen bug.
It's safer than
I didn't have a seatbelt on. I was thrown out of the car, which is the only thing that saved my life, because those frames fold up.
Yeah.
Like an accordion.
Yeah.
Look at the Fiat.
They absorb car impact.
Okay, so what about the rest of it now?
Now my question on like C, in hotel or tourist home. One space per guest per sleeping room. Okay, but why not one space for employee per largest shift, like you did the other one?
I agree.
Oh, one space for each employee per shift?
For largest shift.
Okay, for largest shift.
So we stay consistent with the in the same under retail stores. One space per 300 square feet of store space, plus one space for each 5 employees per shift, per largest shift. Because if you have 20 employees, but there's only so many on per shift.
Okay.
And then the same
should
with the last
largest
month.
Or longest?
Largest.
Because that would be the one where you got the most.
The most people.
During the day, you're going to have chamber maids and all that.
Okay,
so
everyone is like that, then we put per
the same
largest.
In the commercial, plus one space for each 5 employees per largest shift. And that way...
Yep.
We're not telling them, well, you got 20 part-timers, you need 20 spaces. Well, the most we ever have on at a time is 6.
Right.
All right, then you need 6.
Okay, so largest shift. That's just floor space. One space for 2 seats.
I got so many copies of it, so...
Would be C, H, and I.
I didn't have any trouble trying to open it, so you need too many spots. I didn't bring mine out.
Restaurant or eating place. One space per 2 seats. No employees allowed.
Says nothing and says both. Well, that's
no employees
very,
allowed.
Very good.
They have to do.
Plus how many for people?
Right.
How many would it be there?
You need
one
well,
per shift
thingy
again?
The same thing, yeah. Like
one space
for
largest
shift. Human.
Right now,
restaurants can't have employees.
One space
per employee on
for
shift.
Each employee of the largest shift.
Mm-hmm.
I have a hard time with going to blanket covers of larger shift for everything, because it really, a restaurant doesn't have traditional shifts.
Of course you do.
You have peak times.
You have one shift.
So those
you
would be your
no, you don't have one shift.
Shift.
You have people. Some people are going to come in beforehand. You're going to have people that come in at prep time. They're going to have people that come in and.
But
do,
if.
Yeah, but where you.
If the Tilton Diner has a monstrous lunch, breakfast crowd. and they've got 16 employees on that breakfast crowd, that's their largest shift, then
but their breakfast, but their breakfast and their lunch staffs overlap. Okay, some of your breakfast staff.
But then we can go on the shift.
Because you have a, because the way we're saying it is you have a breakfast shift and you have a lunch shift.
We're not saying we're talking about
when you call your employees in until they
the maximum number that you have at any given time is what we're saying. And that's what we're defining as a larger shift.
We have to put in this ordinance, especially in that particular clause, that the employees have to have a place to park.
Right.
Also. And that one doesn't say we have employees. Right? But if they've got 16 employees, then you allow 16 spaces for their employees. And if there's some overlap, because some are leaving, some are going.
But you'll never have more than 16.
If they expect 16 on their biggest shift,
right.
You know, even including their overlap, and maybe they have 12 and 16 is inclusive of their overlap, then we want to allow for their 16.
Okay, so now on the example, I put a hotel with a restaurant and a conference center would include C, D, and I.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's so that you can, you know, boom, boom, boom,
it's all inclusive.
Right.
Would it be C, D, and, or C, D, or I? So they can pick the one that best qualifies for them.
Well, no, because you have to cover C.
Yeah.
You have to cover D, and then you have to cover I.
Yeah.
It's C, D, and I.
Yeah, okay.
It's not, because otherwise I'll go one for 300 feet
options.
And I'll have
all
the
different
rooms
options
in there.
Yeah.
Because our hotel room is, what, 200 square feet?
Right. Okay, now what about the other one?
What about parking? What about, just keeping on this parking?
Okay.
What about, and this is just when I was going through other stuff, travel lanes. And travel lanes in a parking lot. If you have angled parking versus straight on parking, you should have different widths.
But isn't that part of the site plan?
Yeah, that would be.
Well, you have to have a regulation for that. You can't just say, "Yeah, I'm going to have you have 25 feet."
Well, what you do.
And you're
going
to have 20 feet. I mean,
this gives you the authority to say, "No, you do not have enough parking spaces in your lot for the size." But now the overall dynamics of the parking lot, in other words, how wide you want the aisles between spots and stuff like that. That all comes out in the site plan.
Well, a lot of these places have...
You can have in your site plan, in the site plan regulations, you can have the overall dynamics. The zoning has to get down with the meat and potatoes, or this would go in your zoning. In your site plan now, you can further it by putting something in over the area you expect for a row, I mean, I think, and the spaces, you know, the overall size of the lot and what you want for your entrance roads, your exit roads, this, you know, the roads in between the rows, that can all be part of your site plan.
This is the minimum requirements we accept.
Right.
Site plan is the deviances that we will allow.
Right.
And the specifics to that spot.
Someone might come in, and this might be our minimum that we're going to allow, but maybe they want to put more in, you know, because they found in their others, say if it's a hotel or something, that their conference center down in Concord is pulling far more in than what they anticipated. So as they build this one up here, they wanted to give more parking available to the conference center.
Well,
so they may come in and want more than what you're saying they can have, but this would just say we won't accept
less correct.
Than what
we could. You could look at this and say, okay, if let's say MB Tractor, to use as an example, okay, most of those people are driving trucks that are 9 by 24 feet,
right,
and 9 by 19 doesn't work in that situation. We can turn around and say, well, you're gonna need more.
Yes,
but like on some of these other regulations that I use for my reference, you know, a lot of them say like minimum aisle width one way is 18 feet, two ways 24 feet.
But those are site plans, I believe, aren't they?
No, these are regulations. These are parking space requirements.
Okay.
Minimum parking space, 9 by 18. Minimum aisle width one way, 18 feet, two ways 24 feet. Because otherwise someone's going to come in and with a site plan, they're going to have two rows of parking and they're going to come in at 22 feet and we're going to say, well, no, we're going to have to, you know.
There is absolutely nothing that says that you cannot say to him, I will not accept 22 feet between rows. Because what happens in that row of parking?
Well, we should state that. This way they don't come into us with 22 feet.
Well,
we should come
it's
up
amazing
with a
how agreeable they are when they're wanting an approval for the site plan. And how many times when a site plan comes in, not that I'm not saying you can't put it in here, but I'm just saying, as long as you are going over the plans with them, there is no reason, if you say, I want to see 2 more feet per row, they're going to put in 2 more feet per row.
Right, but now the business is going to come into incur the expense of having to rewrite those plans because your opinion, per se, is going to be that you don't want 22 feet, you want 24 feet. But if they came in knowing that, they're going to come with the plan.
True. No, there's nothing saying we couldn't add that. They'd take that whole section on what you want to see.
Right.
There's no reason why you couldn't.
But most of our site plans come in written by engineers.
Right.
And they know what it takes to turn traffic and what it takes to...
But they're going to try to maximize their space, so if they're going to shortchange something by a foot, even though, it's not going to be that. But if we say specifically that we want it to be 22 or 24
feet. You're saying...
I guess I'm looking for more.
You're looking for more, just to be an advocate.
Put more.
You want Jay, Jay saying with a minimum of 22 feet per...
My only thought when I did this, it was I said, you know, it would be better if we start out just basic.
Yeah.
We can always add to it. But you don't want to put something into place that...
But then we're
going to
get into the problems that we have with a lot of the signs. You know,
let's
cover it at the beginning when we do this, and then you know we'll kind of.
So it sounds to me like that could be added to this very first.
Would you like a J that states with a minimum of 22 feet between rows?
It could all be up here where it says a parking space is not to be less than 9 by 19 rows between.
One way shall be. What did you say?
18 feet, and the other one 2-way or 24 feet. You know.
Oh, that's fine. We'll put
you know, handicap spaces should be compliant with ADA. I mean, though that's common sense, but
they must have. You know, especially one thing it doesn't show here is, especially like in a hotel, restaurant, retail. You know, that
there
you
is,
should have X number of handicap.
There is a rule.
Van accessible.
Yes, there is a rule
part of the ADA?
That tells you the overall size of the parking lot, how many of those spaces. Percent it should be for ADA.
And that's a federal requirement.
Right.
So,
okay, so then we don't have to restate what the feds say.
Right.
Well, we've already been through a lot of this with John. You know, with his parking lot and his parking at the building, you know. I just don't see where we have to add a whole.
But I mean, I think Eric brings up a good point. If we take that first sentence at the start where it starts off-street parking shall provide as follows, and we say a parking space shall not be less than 9 by 19, and the travel ways between rows for, you know, one way will be 18 feet, two ways would be 24, so that you can have the two cars passing. Because one thing that I've noticed, and I'm sure you all have noticed this too, is overall in a lot of the towns, parking lots seem to be shrinking up.
Mm.
I think one of the worst ones I've been in is the Shaw's in Concord. Have you ever tried to move around in that parking lot?
Is that the one up by Stickering?
Yes.
No, I haven't been in there.
That's it is nasty.
It is really nasty. You get one
now that
long
I've,
pickup parked in there with his rear end sticking out.
I drive a full-size pickup now, and I'm finding that it's a little bit tougher to get it into these spaces than...
Yeah. Go up to Tanger and try to put it in the parking
lot. Yeah, Tanger is shrunk.
But look, even at the senior center.
I saw somebody at the senior center, not the senior center, but at the other one next door where the curbs are now, go right up over a curb the other day trying to pull out. I went, uh-oh.
I've seen that at Hanford. Somebody
parking, the senior center doesn't have designated parking spaces.
They park on the western side, and they went right over the curbing and down there.
I went by there the other day, and it was
But I mean, mostly, you know, like I'll see... like these really long trucks, they'll pull in and just take up two spots.
With
they'll
the full
pull,
size
yes.
club cab.
Yes, and then
thinking.
They'll they extend it back in. You know, they're really long, but they usually will pull up and take two spots. You know, pull right through, so that their rear end isn't hanging out. But they leave it, like at the Shaw's, if they leave their rear ends out, it's almost impossible to get by them.
See, like for instance, I'm just going to go back, because I work in the hotel business, so I'm going to reflect on that.
Yeah.
But like where I work, we have to have, per town regulations, we have to have 1 1/4 space for every guest room. The reason why is we have 1, 2, and 3 bedroom units. So if you take 1 space per guest sleeping room, well, if me and a couple of my buddies decide to go get a room, we may each have a car, and if we have two, if you have a suite, for instance, you know, you're going to have maybe 3 or 4 cars in 1 room.
Well, yeah, we granted, it can happen. It can happen, but on the other side of it, I know when I was, all the time that I was in when we were talking about the best management practices, you are encouraged to keep parking lots as small as possible as far as the pavement, with the idea in mind that the extra area that they wanted to pave is there and it's natural, you know, grass, whatever, to where, you know, find out. Spend a couple years there. And then if you need to expand your parking lot, you do. But if you start out already where you're making these huge parking lots for these places, they may not be needed.
Oh, no, I agree. But, I mean, in a hotel environment, take, for instance, the Hampton Inn, when you go by their bike week, which is, you know, 1 week a year, or maybe some of the race weekends, you know, people have trailers, and they're pulling in straight from the highway, and they're parking those spaces because they're flat and they can park their trailers on the grass.
Right.
You know, I'm sure when they came before the planning board before that, no one even thought of that. It's one of those things that, you know,
right.
You know, do they put a fence across there? I mean, you know, it's those types of things that, you know, okay. But, you know, just working, knowing from, you know, where I work, you know, mm-hmm. we're trying to build another resort. And, you know, we're able to count the parking spaces on an adjoining mall as space because there's an agreement.
Right.
You know, we can count those towards our needed parking spaces. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to have a huge parking lot, because when that mall isn't busy is when we're going to be busy. When we're not busy, the mall is busy. So.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay, so we're going to put at the top here, parking space shall be not less than 9 by 19, and then we're going to say the travel way.
Yeah.
Between rows.
What is it, 18?
Do 18 feet for one way?
One way, yeah.
18 feet for one way.
24 for two.
And 24 feet for two way. It's wrapping. And then why don't we just add something here saying handicapped parking shall follow federal
ADA guide.
ADA
yeah, ADA.
Federal ADA.
Okay. Handicapped parking.
I think you just have to say ADA guidelines.
Handicapped parking spaces
all parking
shall
parking. Follow ADA guidelines.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Handicapped parking spaces shall conform to
the dimensional.
I wouldn't
even use the word handicap. It's redundant.
Requirements of the ADA.
It is.
ADA.
Dimensional requirements.
Dimensional requirements.
Oh, it's
a dimensional word.
Requirements.
Some words.
And I put shall conform to ADA.
Okay. Will conform to.
Much better word.
Yes. To ADA dimensional requirements. Okay. Anything else?
Just our leeways and controls.
And I mean, we can always, as the years go on, you know, like next year, if we find that there was something glaringly missing, there's no reason why you can't add to what you have. Mm-hmm. But this seemed nice and simple and an easy way to start.
Yeah.
Get something on the books.
Yes. And as you go through and you're working with things, you know, you can certainly. I used to, you know, cases that come up in the section that whatever we were working with, I just make notes. Need something to define, or, you know, whatever it would be.
On this first thing,
Oh, on setbacks?
Yeah.
Okay.
The only thing that I'm having a problem with is in that first line, talking about, you know, the purpose of most setbacks and safety from possible accidents flying onto a property.
Yeah, I got that.
Makes it sound like a plane crash.
Yeah, I didn't think that was necessary.
Okay.
And snow removal didn't seem necessary.
Okay, so safety from possible accidents, traffic accidents.
Yeah.
No, snow removal, because when the state comes by and they're plowing your...
I don't have a problem with snow removal.
Yeah, I don't either.
I think that needs to be in there. That's one of the reasons you're leaving that front setback open, because the town or the state is gonna plow snow into that front setback.
Yeah.
And if you got something there that they can destroy, they will.
Oh, they do all the time.
Yeah.
We place mailboxes consistently.
Yeah. Okay, so we got rid of flying under the property. Buffers from other land uses such as commercial to residential. And to provide open space around structures and lots. That paragraph is just to kind of give justification some of the things that, you know, you're looking at, like for, you know, structure-free area for utilities, for either bearing lines and pipes, or, you know, your telephone line. It just gives justification for why you're doing it. There is no doubt that insisting on setbacks is a form of a taking. You're telling somebody they can't use that property, for the most part, for things. I mean, there's things you can do in it. You know, and I thought it was important that you leave someone, you know, like residential stuff, the planning board has no say in anything residential, unless it's coming in to develop. But I mean, if the residents are already out there, they don't have to come in and site plan. Mm-hmm. But they do have to be able to get permits for things. And I know Al does require permits for fencing and things like that. We didn't used to, but they do now. So at least by having something like that, you have someone that is going to make sure they're not running their fence right out to the property line and, you know, messing up everybody's sight distance, you know, nothing like trying to creep out to see if he can go or not. And, you know, that's primarily why I put that part in. Somebody needs to look at it. Someone needs to be able to say, you can't put that there because your neighbor can't see to get out of his driveway. I mean, I know it sounds like a no-brainer, but it's amazing. I know when Joe worked here, how many times he had to go out and say, I told you not to run the fence right up to the property line. Your neighbor can't get out now without sticking his whole front end of his car out in the travel lane. So you need something, and this way it's in writing.
It legislates stupidity, because that would...
Yeah.
What do you do when somebody parks a vehicle there constantly and you can't see?
Well, what we used to do is we would tell the people, I said, well, have you gone next door and talked to your neighbor and you said, could you move it down a little bit more just so I can, you know, when I'm trying to get out, see? That seems to be the best approach, first of all. If you just try to have a casual conversation with them about it.
Well, look on Chestnut Street, those bushes were growing right over the sidewalk. And I mean, I'm sure the property owners didn't even know it was bothering anybody.
Right.
You know, because they probably never walked along there because they went to the side to get in their car. But there was a sidewalk and the bushes had completely grown over so that there was no visible sidewalk.
Right. Mm-hmm. And it also makes it hard. I know the people who live up on the corner by Winter Street, they had all those bushes out there. And when you would come to the stop sign there to turn on to Clark or Colby, well, when you'd look down Clark, you had to stick your nose out there to see beyond the bushes.
You're talking about what used to be Dixon's and now...
Well, the same thing at the bottom of Jocelyn. We had the forsythias that just overgrew and and overtook even the mailboxes. And you had to get out on Route 3 before...
Well, problem with forsythias is you
put them in the ground, you have to jump out of the way because they grow that fast.
That's an undesirable, I think, and that up there.
Where? What?
There's a sign up there with some of the, like, what's that thing that we cut down? Remember the night we cut down over at Chilton House of Pizza? What's it called? It turns different color. It
burning
turns
bush.
Oh, the burning bush.
Oh, burning bush. I love burning bush.
Well, that's on that list of lethal plants.
I know, but I'd love to have
one. Well, now it is. When we put ours in, they weren't illegal, but...
I don't think they take over anything.
But we also didn't put it out there by the road where it's going to block somebody's view.
Oh, they do. Oh, they do.
So is it red maple?
Yeah.
You can't buy red maple.
I love bittersweet.
Red maple, you can't buy it in the state of New Hampshire.
But why? What's wrong with red maples?
Well, they say they're invasive.
They are.
Purple loosestrife.
Oh, my friend had to go to New York and get hers. She's got two. She planted two of them in Timberton.
Red maples are?
They're what?
They're deadly to some animals.
Yeah, they are. I just read that. I saw it on the Discovery Channel.
You know, our deer are very smart because they only eat the bushes that seem to be...
The fruit trees.
I feel like I have a drive-in Burger King or something. In the wintertime, you can look out at night and I'll have deer plugged into every bush all around the house.
All right. Well, should we put that in our...
Yeah.
All right. Anything else?
Will we adjourn?
Okay, now Jane's gonna sign something, and we gotta
review
this. Yes,
so we gotta just review John Bernard.
I withdraw my motion.
We still have work to do.
You can hold your motion.
Okay, then we have to do what my dad did. He made a deal with the deer. He puts out a big pot, like this big, fills it with cracked corn. He made a deal with the deer. Keep that full. You keep my plants, and it's working.
Well, you know, I found it.
Did they sign off on that document?
I don't know.
Okay. I think I made the mistake. We had one year where we had all those terrible snows, and the deer was the only year I can ever remember where the state said you could put food out for them because they were starving and the snow was so deep. So I went to Agway and I bought big bushel baskets of apples.
Who's this? What's this?
It's a lot larger.
And then we got corn.
Am I supposed to sign that?
Well, after having the apples, they weren't interested in the corn.
Yeah, but we're trying to prove it.
The same thing with my dog. Give her treats. She'll want your dog food.
Right. My cat's the same way. It's just, I'm just having treats.
Herb Shaw used to feed the turkeys, and one morning you didn't feed them, and it was you opened the door, and they came in the kitchen.
Well, I laughed at him one time because he says, you know, they're just getting too much, they're demanding, and I said,
This is just going on.
How are they demanding? They're outside.
I thought I had
sent out
here, but
on the window,
yes, I do.
All right, here we go.
This is that's the
and even more, he said, if I don't turn on the TV for them, they don't like it.
Yeah.
I don't like this
program.
Okay. Here it is.
My sister feeds her squirrels M&M's. They come to her slider and stand up there.
What does he do? Does he certify it?
Well, she walks by it there.
Eric.
He says it's a secretary.
Unbelievable. I know he has to sign it too, but I don't know where.
Are you getting his conditions of approval? So he can make sure he's done everything he's supposed to do?
This is the parking lot. 19 spaces.
I thought he had 17. He did, because this was always the 17th, remember? And we didn't think there was room for it, and it appears from here that there is.
It looks good over there.
Yeah. Well, the funny thing is that we park over in his lot now, and he parks over in our lot. They park over in our lot now, and he just went to me. I said to him, look at all your people parked over here. I told you we shouldn't have gotten lawyers in.
Yeah. Well, the main thing you wanted to do was just so that when you wanted to be open at the senior center, you have places to park. Because at times they did get carried away.
Well, when there was people parking out in the street.
Yeah.
That's the street.
Yep.
here is the condition of approval of R9.
Yeah, just before.
Wait, look at that, wait.
This is the R950.
Okay, what are the conditions?
All right, earthen berm and shrubbery from southwest corner to the limit of the driveway.
And that's.
Yep.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Barrier along Route 3 to be earthen berm with shrubbery from parking spots 6 through 17.
But I believe we changed that.
Yeah, we did change that.
Yeah.
We changed that.
Yeah. No classes or group activities during chiropractic hours.
Well, that, that is.
No more than one event at a time, group activity room. Snow storage to be on the Route 3 side of the property.
And that's where it's at.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Small direction signs on the property stating parking and designated spaces. Handicap parking will meet state and federal requirements. You see handicap.
The one here.
You weren't talking, you should have listened to her.
That silence flats flat on buildings.
That might be this.
That's his sign.
Well, he has a sign here. There's a sign here.
Is that the electrical box?
Probably. No, here's the electrical box.
Yeah, he has a sign on this too.
Box there.
This is construct 2 foot tall.
It's a relocate sign, so I don't know if that's.
Where's the, did we have them put, I don't see any notification that there's a shrubbery or anything like that.
Well, I don't think.
Cause obviously this is landscape area, what is this?
That's supposed to be landscape too.
Well, it may just be that he's waiting till spring.
There should be.
It needs to be on the plan.
There's no,
No notes?
Barrier along Route.
No.
No, wait.
C note, what, is that, C note?
Note 8.
Note 8.
Well, the other thing is call him tomorrow and tell him that the board is not adverse to signing it, but there is no landscaping and no notes saying that he's going to do it in the spring or anything else.
Well, I thought he had a, is this the corner we're talking about? He had to put something here?
Yeah,
he has got the barrier behind the driveway.
Up to the driveway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he put a berm in there, didn't he?
Yeah, it's kind of, yeah.
So the berm's in there, but he probably can't plant bushes until spring.
Oh, but it's not listed on here, is it?
But get something in writing from him. And across the front, we changed their mind because he's already got the retaining wall there. What does he need a berm for?
He said that's
what
he needed.
Yeah, so it seemed redundant.
Mm-hmm. And this looks awful.
What looks awful?
Well, we made him remove the pavement.
Yeah,
it
does look terrible.
I mean, it does. There's pavement. Mm-hmm. Then there's this
but
big
it's right here that I saw the person backing out here over the curb.
Is he going to landscape those?
We can.
Pavement's right up to the property line, isn't it?
Yeah, he can.
Yeah. Yeah, isn't it like all
it just is
dirt this way, this here?
And if it rains, it's just mud.
Well, these are paved though, aren't they?
Can you put gravel down or something?
Yeah, why can't you put gravel
across the
stone
or
might.
A hard pack or something?
We've got that drainage issue, I think that's the thing right now.
Yeah.
That's going to have to be, that's an issue.
Yeah, that's a lot
of
that's a big issue.
Yeah.
He hasn't broken ground for the parking lot yet, has he? Behind
he's got something going on down there.
He's working on it.
Yeah.
They put a fire hydrant over there.
What's going on in Shaley's property across from the golf course? There was a guy working over there with a bulldozer.
I know, I saw somebody.
Yeah,
actually.
I didn't know.
When I saw them at first, I thought they were hunters.
Yeah.
And then I saw, came by, and they had a bulldozer, and said, no, that's not a hunter.
Nothing beats hunting with a bulldozer.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they're just in there knocking down the growth so that.
No, it's more than that, I think.
They flattened it out. Although, the big rocks out and everything.
Many months ago, they should be.
No.
I do not know.
Why not?
If anybody would know, it should be her. Did they come and get a permit of any kind?
Was there an issue with that instructor inside there?
Oh, she would have said something.
Yeah.
Maybe a permit for nothing.
So anyway, why don't you just tell him that the board has no objections to signing, but there's no landscaping there, and nothing on the notes of the plan saying it's going to be landscaping.
Yeah, because it was supposed to be all on.
So the board would like some kind of a letter from him that we can put
in
his file, that he will be doing the landscaping in the spring.
Yeah, he's got some in here, but I mean, there's no notations here saying that it's required.
Well, we just want to see him again for Christmas.
Well, we're not going to see him again before Christmas. We ain't meeting until January 8th.
Well, then he just wants to see you.
Just tell him that. If he will give the letter to the town that you can put in his file stating that he will finish the landscaping next spring.
Then I will sign it.
Then Jenny will come in and sign it. We have something in the file stating, you know, that he got his job here. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
All right, let's go back to you. Is there anything else?
I make a motion to adjourn.
I'm asking.
All in favor?
Aye.
So we're done?
We're done.
Yay!
Everyone's just looking at each other.
No, that means we can go now.
Oh, let's just hang out for a little bit.
You have right at that panel.
All right, is the tape turned off?
Wait a minute, nope. Hang on.
Anybody want to take a trip to the...
Trip to what?